world. In August of this year, I started a little diet to lose some body fat, and wasn't really aiming to lose a lot of weight, but just wanted to cut some body fat, and I used Python to help me do it. So I have an Excel sheet that I was using to track everything, but I wanted more of a dashboard to help me visualize it to know if I'm on track or not. Excel is fine for most things. You can use it for whatever you want, but it has limited distribution and you can't really integrate it into anything else. So basically, I'm trying to create my own fitness app, and this is the skeleton of one that you would create. And so let's check it out what I mean. But first, welcome to the 191st video on my channel where I'm building my own digital assistant named Shane, like Jarvis from the Iron Man movies and comics. This is the third video in my Python for Fitness playlist. You can watch the other two videos by clicking here. And I recommend watching those because I'm going to kind of go over some topics really quickly that I went in more details in previous videos. Please consider subscribing to my channel if you want to continue watching me build my own digital assistant. And like this video and leave a comment if you got some fitness goals and or ideas on how you can use Python to help you out. So now let's check it out. But we're going to start off in Excel. So this is kind of my quick Excel that I was using, just the date. I would weigh in every day at the same time. That's important. I did it right when I woke up, but after I took ate some grapes and some protein shake. And then I created a high estimate and a low estimate. And so please do watch my previous videos if you want more information on it. But basically, 1 pound of fat is 3,500 calories. So, like I said, the goal wasn't really to lose weight, but you kind of have to lose weight if you're in a calorie deficit. And so, 3,500 calories a day divided by 7 days, if you're measuring it week to week, is 500 calories. So, if you want to lose 1 pound a week, you should eat less than 500 calories. And I went over how to calculate all of that. You have to find your basal metabolic rate, calculate how much you burn while working out, and then how much you eat in a day and how to calculate those macros. And so what I did was take the high estimate was around 300 calories a day, and a low estimate was 500 calories a day. So I'm a small guy, so losing a whole pound a week would be unsustainable. I'd probably shut down my metabolism and just become skinny fat. And so that wasn't the goal. The goal was to build muscle. And then I just every day I would open this Excel and enter some data into this actual weight column. And so as you can see, I left my birthday, which was today. I left that off of there because yesterday was my final weigh-in. But I weighed myself this morning, and we'll use Python to enter that last data point. And so when we can graph this out. So I just made a little graph. Let me shrink my head real quick. And so I made just a quick graph starting here. And this is the low estimate, right? If I only lost 300 calories. And this is the high estimate where I lost 500 calories a day. That wasn't the goal. And as you can see, I managed to go in between there. Now, if you measure every day, if you weigh yourself every day, you're going to have like water retention issues and things that aren't really affecting it, right? And to include your bathroom schedule, quantity and amount, not to get gross or anything. But roughly, if you measure yourself at the same day, same time every day, then you can compare your Monday to Monday, your Tuesday to Tuesday, assuming you eat normally and you work out regularly. I'm a very routine guy, so really every day is the same, so it's easy to compare. But if you're comparing every day, you're going to kind of get frustrated because you can't control certain aspects of your body, to include like sleep too. Quality of sleep is a huge determinant on whether you're going to reach your fitness goals. So this line is kind of what I was hoping for. I was kind of hoping that it would arch down, but I do have some insomnia issues, and the day after insomnia, I do overeat that next day to keep me keep some calories in me. And then also every Sunday we go to eat as a family, and so you'll see these spikes. And if I plotted these spikes out, that would probably be Mondays, these large spikes, which is the morning before the morning after we went out to eat somewhere. And I try to eat healthy as much as you can, but if we went to a burger joint or somewhere, then it's difficult. So this is great. This is Excel. You have to open it up, enter the data, close it, regraph it, which is, it's all easy, right? If you wanted to create a comprehensive fitness app, you can't do it in Excel. So what I did was I created the same thing using Plotly Dash. And let's check that out. So I'm going to run this program now and show you all. And now if you remember, we left the 12 November entry off. And so I'll enter this morning's weight in there. So it's going to run. That's just because my computer's slow. It'll go away in a second. All right. So you see we have nothing on this graph. So let's press show graph. Okay. So now we have our graph, right? This is my weight. This is the date. This looks very similar, just kind of zoomed in to the Excel. It ends on 11 November because we haven't entered the 12 November date yet. And as you can see, it's the same way. And now we can enter our weight. So I weighed 146 this morning. Okay, so I didn't enter that date. You remember the 12 November was wrong. And so I'm going to enter 146. That's what I weighed this morning. And I'm going to press submit. All right. So I didn't add any logic to show that it successfully saved here, but I did do a print statement. It says Excel has been saved. And so if we go back to that Excel, open it up. There you go. We have 146 there. And so now we can go ahead and refresh it by pressing show graph. You see that 11 November is the last entry. All right, and now we have 12 November as the last entry at 146. Right, so this is just the beginning. There's also no logic in there, so I can keep pressing submit and it's going to keep going. So there's, and I'll show you what I mean in a second, but there needs to be logic to make sure that we don't go beyond today's date. That would be an enhancement. So let's go into PyCharm and see how we created this. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to have to pip install Dash and Plotly, Pandas, OpenPyXL. All of these are easy to do if you just go to Settings, open your project name, Project Interpreter, press the plus button, and then add each one. Under the new Dash, you just need to open import Dash, not all the other parts of it, which is nice. So we're going to import Dash. We're going to import OpenPyXL, which is how we mess with Excel. Then from Dash, we're going to import HTML, DCC, input, output, state, all with capital letters. Import Pandas as PD. Import Plotly.Express as PX. And then import plotly.graphobjects as go. All right, then app equals dash dot dash, D is capitalized. And then you're going to put this name, this dual underscore name on the front and back. And then we're going to do prevent initial callbacks equals true, and I'll show you what that means in a second. Then the app.layout equals html.div, div is capitalized. And here we're going to build the website, if you will, you know, the actual dashboard. So first we have the input box, the ID equals weight, right? That's the HTML ID. The placeholder says enter weight, which is just the text that copies over when you write on it. And the type is text. We handle the fact that it's a float later on. Then we have two buttons that you saw. One was the submit button. One was the one that says show graph. Then we had our graph, which was what we're calling the HTML chart. Then we have this this portion underneath it, HTML.p, and we're going to pass it the children dummy, the ID dummy, and it's hidden equal true. And what this allows you to do is pass the information when we hit the submit button. Because even though it doesn't show a submit button, or even though it shows a submit button, You need to handle that. You can't just have a, you can't just press enter, right? So you press the submit button, but this is hidden, this action right here. So all it does is update the Excel and that's it. So you need this dummy ID and children to prevent any errors you might get. Then our first app.callback, we're going to output to the chart the figure, and I'll show you what the figure looks in a second. The input is going to be this refresh button, right? The show graph button. And we're going to pass it the number of clicks. The number of clicks is just going to be one, right? Because we're just pressing submit. And then prevent initial callback is true. Then we're going to pass our function. That's the function that this app.callback uses. And we're going to display the chart. So we're going to pass it the number of clicks, and as long as the number of clicks is not none, right? So if you press, this is another way of saying that the number of clicks is more than one, or one or more. First, we're going to have this Excel sheet, pd.readExcel. The weight tracker is SLSX. We can do it as a CSV if we wanted, that's fine. Then a data frame equals this, right? The figure equals is going to be, this is the Plotly Express, right, that we imported here. So Plotly Express dot line, we're going to pass it the data frame. The X is date. The Y is actual weight. I could have changed the date to something else, but I don't need to. And then we're going to add our first trace, which shows us the high estimate, right? So go dot scatter. Scatter is the what you use to make the traces. So this is the dotted green and the dotted red lines. So first we're going to pass the X coordinate, which is the date, which is in the data frame. Then the high estimate, that's the column name. The name, I just called it high estimate. And then to make a line, you need to make a dictionary and pass it all the different things you want, right? I just wanted a green, color green line and a dashed line, right? Secondary Y is false. I want this all on the same Y-axis. If you move that to true, you can make a secondary Y-axis. And I made a whole video on how to handle multiple Y-axes. And you can watch that video by clicking here. Same thing, we add another trace. This is going to be the low estimate, which is the column low estimate. And then this time we're making a dashed red line, also on the same y-axis. And then we're going to return the figure, right? And that's what this is looking for. I should have called this fig, to be honest, but I called it figure. It doesn't matter, but just good naming protocol. I should have put figure equals px dot line. But anyways, and then change these figs to figure. Then the second thing we're going to do is handle the submit button. And every time we press the submit, if the bar is refreshed, we're going to the output is going to be this dummy and children information. And remember, that's what is in here, right? This dummy information. And then the input, where it's supposed to look, is the submit button. And it's going to record the number of clicks. The state is going to be the weight and the value. So that is up here. So right here, ID, this is what we're going to capture, right? And what we want is the value of this. So that's what this is, the ID number, and then what's in there. This is the ID number or the ID name, and this is the value. So. And then the prevent initial callback equals true. Then we're going to save the new entry using the number of clicks and whatever was in the input value. So again, as long as the number of clicks is not none, so one or more, then we're going to establish a workbook equals openpyxl.load workbook. And this is the weight tracker SLX. Then we want the sheet equals workbook.active. Now, this is not good practice I've learned while making this video because I left it on this one right here. So I left it on the graph and I got a bunch of errors that I omitted when I was recording this. And so this right now would be the active sheet, which would cause an error if I tried to run the program. So what you can do and what I have not done is you establish which worksheet you want. But for now, sheet equals workbook.active. And then I want to find the last open row in column B, which was the actual weight column. And how you do this is this kind of long single line right here, abstracted line right here. So the last empty entry equals the max of column B dot row for B in sheet, which is the active workbook, in column B, right? So this is called an abstract line. If B dot value is not none, plus one. So what it's doing is it's finding the last, this is column B, it's finding the last empty row plus one, right? So this is the last entry plus one, and that's how it enters new information. All right. Now what I should do is an if then, or if statement right here, and says if the date, right? If the date is blank, or if I extended this out longer, if the date is greater than today, tell the user, you know, throw an error that says, sorry, you cannot enter weight beyond this day, right? But I don't have that. And then C.1 equals sheet.cell, row equals last empty entry, which is this one, which is the plus one, column two, right? So we're identifying which cell we want to write information to. And then C1.value equals a float of input value. And we pass the input value from right here, this state. All right. And then we're going to save the workbook. And then at the bottom of this, print Excel has been saved, which is what you see here. Or I could have brought this back up and added a new HTML thing at the bottom that says your Excel has been updated. I could have done that as well. And then that's the end of that function. So if underscore underscore name underscore underscore, right, which is what we identified here, right? So it comes back to here and looks for this dash. Then that is called main. And then we're going to start the program app.run server debug equals true. Debug is just this information down here. And if we did other stuff, you would see it down here. And then this is just your local machine. So, you know, you can use this. This is just the beginning of what I plan to use for my fitness. Monitoring my health and my fitness is probably definitely at the top of my list of what I want my digital assistant to do. So I hope you found this interesting, and I'm really excited with my results. I wish it was better, of course, but I wasn't as strict as I should have been. Thanks for watching. Goodbye, world.